ओके मैम।
So we have started the fault analysis. If I got disconnected, then you should inform me via phone. Otherwise, I cannot notice that one. Anyway, so we have started the discussion on transient fault or sudden fault on transmission line. So if there be any fault on transmission line, generally faults in transmission lines are more happening than in the instrument, in the component steels. Fault occurs in the generators, transformers also. There are different protection issue, protection method for that. But generally short circuit faults are more common in case of power transmission line. So if we assume that at power there is a fault in a, at the end of a, at any point in a power transmission line, and then what will happen? Then when there is a fault, then that means that is happening suddenly. So there will be a transient component of current in the fault current along with the steady state component. So fault current at any point of time, this IFT, we can write a steady state component IST along with the transient component IST, ITT, sorry. Around 2150, you should write your roll number in the chat of this meeting. Five minutes before the ending of the class. Anyway, so transient component as well as steady state component will be there, and obviously when the transient component will die down, steady state component will exist if we allow the fault. Now let us find out what will be the amplitude of transient current or steady state current. Why we are bothering about that? Because this current, depending on the amplitude of current, this current we have to actually interrupt. We shall not allow this current. So during faulty condition, we have to interrupt this current and we have to disconnect the unhealthy portion. So if this is the unhealthy portion, that means the fault current is flowing through this circuit. We have to cut the circuit here. So actually we have to interrupt this fault current. For that reason, actually we need the fault analysis. We are interested in the magnitude of current. In the power system planning design class, we have calculated steady state current that is required in design purpose, that conductor, transmission line conductors or cable have to withstand that amount of current throughout its life. So that is the difference. So the instantaneous current through any AC RL circuit is V by Z. So V, if it is RMS value, so root 2 V sine omega t plus alpha. Why alpha? Because initial phase of voltage we have assumed is this alpha angle leading from the reference, for a generalized expression. So by impedance of the line, so impedance of the system at that moment, so root 2 V sine omega t plus alpha by Z. So if the impedance angle is theta, then it is root 2 V by Z sine omega t plus alpha minus theta. So this is the steady state component of current. So obviously root 2 V by Z is constant for that particular fault. So we can write that one as the maximum value of the fault current, and it will vary in a sinusoidal manner. The waveform will depend on our value of alpha and theta. Now, what will be the value of the transient current? Now, say if we assume, we can assume, say for any IC RL circuit, transient current will be, it will have a maximum value and it will decay depending on time constant of the circuit, that is L by R. So the expression is IT max to the power minus RT by L. Okay, this T is the time variation in time. So IT max is the maximum value of transient component of fault current. So it will depend on the circuit. What is the time constant? What is the, where is the fault occur? Depending on that. So total current will be some, obviously the summation of transient current plus the consumption of steady state current plus the transient current. And when t equal to infinity, then the second component, transient component, will die down, and only the steady component exists if we allow the fault. So obviously, if we want to disconnect the circuit as early as possible, then when t is near to zero, then obviously this value of it max, this transient component of, will be higher. So the disconnection of the circuit will be more challenging because the fault current will be higher. If we want to disconnect a higher value of current, then obviously it will be more challenging. More arcing will be there. So breaking will be more, circuit breaking will be more challenging. If you have opened any time, if the knife switch in your machine lab, then you have seen how much sparking is there. And in that case, current is only one within 5 ampere. Now here the current will be in terms of thousands ampere. So it will be quite difficult. So total fault current, IF is the total fault current, instantaneous value. So within bracket it is T. So it is a steady state component along with transient component. Now transient component, it depends on several value, depend on alpha, depend on R and L. So depend on this things of the circuit. So at t equal to 0, there was no fault. So there was no current in the faulted path. So IF0 is 0. So from there we can relate the steady state component and transient component. So transient component at t equal to 0 is just negative of steady state component, because at t equal to 0, current is 0. Fault current is 0. So IT max. So IT max, if we put t equal to 0, then IT max will come minus I max sine alpha minus theta. Or IT max, if we take negative sign inside, so IT max, I max sine theta minus alpha. This I max is the peak steady state current, right? This IT max is the maximum possible current in the transient condition. Now, if we substitute this IT max in this equation, in the expression of fault current, then fault current shall get this type of expression. Now say theta minus alpha, sine theta minus alpha, this term is there in the transient component. So if the sine theta minus alpha value is near to 90 degree or that, then obviously the transient component will be higher. If theta minus alpha is 0, then transient component will be 0, like that. So this theta minus alpha, this transient component value is depends on theta and alpha. Now if we assume a special case, alpha equal to 0, theta equal to pi by 2, why? Because we want to get worst possible condition. So worst possible condition is when alpha equal to 0, theta equal to 90 degree, then this transient component will have maximum value. That means fault current will have the maximum value. So that will be the worst possible condition. So alpha equal to 0 means we are taking voltage as the reference voltage phasor, and theta equal to pi by 2 means we are neglecting x r with respect to x, because this is the r and l. So x, if it is 90 degree, impedance angle 90 degree, that means we are neglecting the r. In that case, yes.
Ma'am, একটা doubt ছিল কি voltage টা আমরা প্রথমেই alpha lead কেন ধরছি, মানে প্রথমেই omega t plus alpha ধরেই derivation টা start করছি কেন?
This is the generalized expression. You can take omega t minus alpha also. That means we are assuming that voltage is not the reference phasor, because in an interconnected power system there is a number of buses, okay? So all the bus voltages cannot be the reference. Like in sending end and receiving end, as you have learned, that for the transmission line, then if we have assumed the receiving end voltage as a reference phasor, is not it? When we have solved the problem in power system planning and design, then sending end voltage is either leading or lagging. Okay. So if this is the sending end voltage, then it cannot be zero.
Yes, ma'am.
Not from there. So this is a generalized expression. So whenever we are assuming alpha equal to 0, so that is also not possible. So actually alpha equal to 0 we are assuming means we are assuming that that is the worst possible condition for the fault current. So if we take the example of a single transmission line, isolated transmission line, that means the fault has occurred near to the receiving end in that way. Understood?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
But in at the receiving end, there is no generator. Okay. So in that way, that is not applicable here. Actually, in the interconnected power system, when I shall teach you the load flow study, then it will be more clear. There may be a number of generators. So if the one generator is reference, then other generators may be lagging or leading, depending on whether it is supplying power or getting power. So in that way, the alpha is maybe positive or negative. Since we are more comfortable with positive sign, that's why I have taken plus alpha. But then why I am taking alpha equal to zero again? Because we want to get a worst condition of the transient current. So worst condition is possible. IT, the maximum possible value of IT max is I max sine theta minus alpha. So what may be the possible value of maximum possible value of the IT max is the IT max. So maximum possible value of IT max is I max when this sine part is 1. When the sine part is 1, so sine part 1 is possible when theta equal to 90 degree or alpha equal to 0 or theta minus alpha equal to 90 degree. Both things may happen. Here, for the ease of understanding, I am assuming that alpha equal to 0, theta equal to 90 degree. But in any case, when theta minus alpha equal to 90 degree, the same thing will happen. The transient component of current will be maximum. So transient component of current will be maximum. So this is the worst possible condition of fault current. But this is not the thing that every time it will happen. This is the worst possible condition. So now you see, this is the worst possible condition of current, expression of current. Since theta equal to pi by 2, so here also I have put theta equal to pi by 2. Now you see, when omega t equal to 0, omega t equal to 0 means this IF is 0. Obviously, when t equal to 0 or omega t equal to 0, then fault current is 0. Obviously, at t equal to 0, fault current will always be 0 because there is no fault. Now, just when omega t equal to just pi, right, then what is happening? Omega t equal to pi, then you see this current, this part, first part is I max. Second part is how much? Omega t equal to pi means how much? Omega t equal to pi, one full cycle is twice pi, right? So this much is pi. So in our 50 hertz system, what is the total cycle? 50 hertz cycle system means 50 cycle in 1 second. So 1 by 50 second is required for one complete cycle. So it is 20 millisecond. I hope you can understand. So this much is 20 millisecond. So time for half cycle is only 10 millisecond, right? So if I put 10 millisecond here, if you put here, it will come approximately equal to I max. It will be 0.8 I max or light. That you can calculate in your calculator. So you can approximate it as plus I max. So current will become twice I max. What does it indicate? That means at t equal to 0, current is, that fault current is 0. But within 10 millisecond, current become twice of its maximum steady state value. So that is the maximum possible current possible in the system, because this transient component current is decaying. So then it will decay. So the current will reduce from twice I max depending on the decaying nature of the transient component of current. Have you understood this much?
Yes, ma'am.
So I shall not allow anyone to entry anymore. So magnitude of fault current, that I have written here elaborately so that you can understand it when I shall send you the note. So t equal to 0, IFT equal to 0, therefore I max sign, I have put the values from there. After half cycle, what is happening, I have written in detail. So that is for your understanding. Now this will be the total current. Let us discuss it one by one. So for steady state component of current, you see a steady state component of current is simple, I max sin omega t theta minus alpha minus theta. So this is say the steady state component of current. Okay, assuming that alpha equal to 0, theta equal to 90 degrees, so it will be 90 degree lagging, so it will start from the negative minus negative maximum value at t equal to 0, because here alpha equal to 0, theta equal to minus pi by 2, sorry, theta equal to pi by 2, where I am assuming the worst possible condition. Then if we want to draw the transient component of current, here it max is I max, right, and it is decaying, so at t equal to infinity it will be 0. So these are the two different component of current, one is steady state, another transient. So when these two will be added together, then total current will be within an envelope of e to the power minus RT by L. So this will be the envelope within the e to the power minus RT by L. Total current will be within this and summation of each current, right? So this purple one is the total fault current. So this is the upper envelope, this is the one lower envelope. As we have seen in your traveling wave interpretation of long transmission line, it is like that. So after that, I have drawn this one for a very long time, this decaying component. Actually, this does not happen. So to make you understand, I have drawn this one. But the actual scenario is more, these envelopes are very much steeper as compared to I have drawn. Right. So this is the red one is the transient component, or it is called decreasing DC component or decreasing apodic component of fault current. The blues are the steady state component. But when the transient component, steady state component, both are there, you cannot see them separately in oscilloscope. You will see only this purple color, is not it? Or this magenta color, maybe. Like this, so you will only see. You cannot see these two separately. So these are the components of current. So you can see that at the t equal to 0, current is 0, because the steady state component of current is negative, and the transient component of current at the same value at the exactly opposite. I am repeating that this thing is I am explaining for the case alpha equal to 0, theta equal to 90 degree. Otherwise this transient component of current will may lower, right? I have drawn the worst possible condition. So maximum current is possible this one, and gradually it will die down when the transient component will die down and it will reach the steady state component. So if we want to disconnect the circuit at any moment of time, so that means we may disconnect here, we may disconnect here, we may disconnect here. It is best to disconnect here. But it is not possible because at that point fault was not occurred, so we cannot disconnect. So at any moment of time, if we want to disconnect, then it will be very difficult because current is very high. But the advantage is that for the fault current, always there is a zero crossing. So always it is better to initiate the disconnection of the faulty part near to the zero crossing. It always happens in circuit breaker. So the degree of severity of the fault depends on the degree magnitude of fault current, and you will try to disconnect the circuit near to zero crossing, but it will not happen at the instant zero. It will take some time. So at that time, current will increase either on negative direction or in positive direction. But in both the cases, that will be a current. So that will create a created problem, because we shall disconnect an inductive current. So inductive current means energy is half Li square. So when we disconnect a circuit, say a circuit is there and current is flowing through a circuit. Now if we want to disconnect the circuit, that means what we are doing, we are disconnecting it. So after successful disconnection, there will be an open circuit. A steady voltage will appear across these two points. So that is the successful disconnection. So for that disconnection, whatever current was flowing through a circuit, that was actually inductive current. R is more or less negligible as compared to X. So half Li square will be converted to half CV square. Okay, inductive energy cannot convert it to active power. So half CV square, and C in the circuit system, power system is very low. So the voltage rise will be very high. So for that reason, this current interruption is a very big issue. Okay, so that's why actually we are learning this, how to interrupt, how to measure, how to take the countermeasure for this high voltage rise, that we shall learn in our fourth year first sem in circuit breaker class. So this will be the total picture of the fault currents. So I suggest you should draw every component by your own hand, then you can understand what is happening, otherwise not. Now if you see the actual, say if we assume that this same thing has happened at the terminal of alternator, the alternator is connected to a transmission line, to a load, like you have seen in your sending end and receiving end, one transmission line that you have learned in your power system planning design class. If that happens and transmission line is at no load, at that moment, at the terminal of alternator, there is a short circuit, three-phase short circuit. Then what will happen? So these are the oscillogramic photograph. Okay, oscillogram. From oscillogram, these pictures have been taken. So you can see I have shown you this variation. Okay. For different phases, there will be 120 degree phase shift. So the picture will be to some extent different, but the nature of the figures will be same, right? I have shown you this one because this is easier to understand. You see, I have shown here from the negative side, the steady current has started like this. So this is the variation in fault current. So actually, in a nutshell, that during the initiation of the fault, fault current is very high, but it will decay very sharply. So the decay in the fault current is very sharp, but the magnitude of fault current, the initial stage, is very high. So that situation, that time zone, is called subtransient zone or subtransient current, fault current. Then because this transient, the decay of this transient fault current will not be same. Initially, the slope will be higher, then the slope will be lower, and then finally it will be zero. So when the slope is higher, for example, I cannot say here specific, say up to this zone, the current is very high. So this is called subtransient zone. I am writing only sub. Then the next zone, when the slope is higher, that means the slope is lower, that means transient component has died down at a certain percentage, but still it is there, then it is called transient zone. I am writing only T here. Then when there is no transient component of current, then it is called steady state of fault. So obviously the disconnection will be difficult, most difficult for that subtransient zone, then it will be difficult for transient zone, then it is for steady state zone. But on the contrary, it is better to disconnect the circuit at subtransient zone, because if we allow, as we allow more time to reach the steady state, that means we are allowing to lose the power in an undesired path, right? So both the things are there. So we have to make compromise between these two to get a safer disconnection of the faulted part, as well as not to lose the economy. So what is the subtransient zone, subtransient part of fault current or subtransient period? First few cycles after, also after fault, when fault is very large and falls rapidly, there is no time no time or no cycle can be specified, because it will be entirely dependent on the system and the transient nature of the fault current. So it cannot be defined. Generally, one or two cycles are taken as the subtransient period. Then 2 to 5 cycles are taken as the transient period, when after subtransient period, when transient current is there, but that is quite submissive, and that period is called subtransient period, and that is generally 2 to 5 cycles generally, and after that it is called steady state period. So similarly, the subtransient fault, transient fault, steady state fault will be there. Say when there is a bird, two conductor of a overhead transmission line get shorted through a bird, then it will be a subtransient, then it will be, this fault will be cleared within subtransient period, because for that bird will burst out within a fraction of time. So the system will again return back to the its normal operating condition, right? So this is one example of subtransient fault. Now you see, so within half cycle the current become more or less twice of the for maximum steady state fault current. So generally not twice, if you calculate it will come like 0.8 or 0.85, maybe you calculate it. So generally we do not take it twice, we assume it during subtransient period. Fault current rises, subtransient part rises 80% of steady state fault current. Generally, it is taken as 1.8 of Imax as a ready assessment, and this is called the period when within half cycle the fault current become twice of the steady state current. This thing is called doubling effect of the fault current. I have written here for your understanding, right? So this doubling effect, actually it is required for circuit breaker and also, because what will be the transient behavior of the circuit breaker or subtransient behavior of the circuit breaker, what will be the transient rating or subtransient rating, depending on that depends on this current, because circuit breaker should able to withstand this 1.8 times of steady state fault current for a very short time, because subtransient fault will not exist for a long time. Now let us go for different equivalent circuit of different components used in power system. Why? Because like the Parinut system, if we want to get the fault current, we have to use the Parinut system, but we have to represent every component of power system properly depending on their behavior during the fault, right? So at first, let us go for the alternator. So in alternator, actually there are two type of reactants. One is its armature reactants, another is the leakage reactants. XL means leakage reactants. Leakage reactants is due to the winding. So this total armature reactants and leakage reactants all together is called the synchronous reactants, and armature resistance is there, and the alternator is represented by a voltage induced here, e.g. G for. Now, how the power transfer takes place in a alternator? Power transfer takes place through the air gap flux. So, what is air gap flux? AG for air gap. What is air gap flux? Air gap flux is phi f minus phi f. Phi f is the field flux. Armature flux is opposing the field flux. That is armature reaction. So this is the air gap flux is a field flux minus armature reaction flux. Now, to produce a continuous power, constant power due to a constant prime mover input, the air gap flux should be constant. It is always constant. And it is the tendency of the machine to maintain this air gap flux constant. Now, if there be a fault at the alternator terminal, then what will happen? This IA is the normal current, normal armature current. Okay, it is feeding to the load. So if there be no load, then also this is a minimum armature current flowing through the alternator. It is feeding to the transmission line or anything. Anyway, so when there is healthy condition, then there is a steady phi A. So there is a steady phi AG depending on the alternator design, and alternator was generating the some power. Now fault has occurred. Okay. Then that will affect only the armature current, not the field current, because field is the DC. Field is totally separate in the synchronous machine. So that fault current will affect this armature flux. So what will happen? This armature current will increase. Now it is not armature current, but the fault current. This F for fault, right? Not for field. So then this armature reaction flux will also increase, right? So this increment will be huge, because generally fault current is, when you calculate, it is 1.5 per unit minimum, 1.5, 1.8, 2 per unit. So near to double of the rated current. So this change in armature reaction flux will be huge. And for that reason, air gap flux will try to decrease. But it is the tendency of the alternator, it is the property of the alternator, or any system, it always try to maintain its equilibrium or stability. So it will try to maintain its air gap flux, which is not possible. So what will it do? So one thing it can do, it will increase the field current. But actually what happened during, this is the during subtransient period, when the fault, here the figure is wrong, I shall correct it later. So here the envelope, the low one envelope will be opposite. The fault current is drying rapidly, right? During that time, actually air gap flux is drying, has decreased a lot, because in that case, the fault current is huge, and during the subtransient period, right? So at that time, the field current cannot help to maintain the air gap flux. At that time, actually, the damper winding come into action. Damper winding is the one type of winding that is positioned in the slot of armature, which are short-circuited winding. So during the high armature current, the current induced in damper winding also, the damper winding current will support the winding current, field winding flux, not the armature winding flux. So in that way, it will try to maintain air gap flux, right? So I am repeating, during the subtransient period, the current is very high, then armature reaction flux will be huge. So air gap flux will try to decay, but due to its own property of the synchronous generator to be in equilibrium, it will try to increase the field flux, as well as damper winding will come into action. So damper winding will support the field flux. So damper winding is supporting the field flux, right? So actually it is supporting the field flux. That means it is actually reducing the air gap flux, right? So in that way, we can assume that in that case, that armature winding and field winding, damper winding, as well as if they are in parallel. One parallel, because they are actually opposing this one, but they are actually in putting the field flux. So for that reason, the effective reactance, synchronous reactance or reactance of the alternator are decreasing. So we can represent that condition by parallel combination of inductors only. But you must remember, this XF and XDW are not in the armature circuit. They are not the part of this, the position of damper winding is totally different. They are not electrically connected with the armature winding or the the field winding is totally different. They are not connected to armature winding. But the behavior of the system at that moment can be represented by as if the contribution of the field winding and armature winding in such a way that will try to reduce the armature reaction flux, right? So for that is represented by the parallel circuit only. So if we now represent, say, by the synchronous reactance, then initially the synchronous reactance was only the armature reactance plus the leakage reactance. Now armature reactance is actually representing the armature reaction. So now armature reaction is reduced because field winding and damper winding are acting in opposition to the armature flux. That's why they are parallel. So effective armature reaction is reduced, right? So for that reason, this effective reactance is reduced. So that's why effective XS is reducing. XS means reactance. So that is reduced. So that is not now constant. That is reduced. When there the fault during faulty condition, when the current is very high and that is affecting the IR gap flux very badly. So that condition, this reactance is not called the steady state synchronous reactance, but it is called subtransient reactance, right? For the synchronous machine, for the cylindrical rotor synchronous machine, it is called a synchronous XS double dash. For the salient pole, it may be XG double dash or XQ double dash. I do not know whether you have learned this thing in your machine class or not. Anyway, so this is the subtransient reactance of the alternator. Then what do you think? What will be the relation between this XS double dash or XS? Which one will be higher? XS double dash or XS dash?
XS will be higher.
XS will be higher. So this will be much lower. So this thing will happen for the subtransient period. So when we represent the behavior of the alternator during subtransient period, so then we shall represent this reactance by XS double dash instead of XS, right? And obviously during steady state, it will be XS only. So this will be the difference in the representation. Similarly, if we allow the time to go, then after some time, this time constant of damper winding is very low. So it will disconnect at first. So at that time, only field winding will be there to ride out, to oppose this armature reaction. So at that time, these two will be in parallel, not in parallel, in action. So since this field winding is in action in opposite to armature winding, armature reaction, so actually as if it is trying to reducing the armature reaction flux, so we can represent this by a parallel reactance. So in that case, obviously there is two reactances in parallel, so we can represent this one by XS dash. So in that case, obviously XS dash will be less than XS.
Greater than XS double dash,
right? I hope now you explain why this relationship is you can explain, okay? So for three different conditions, transient period, subtransient period, and steady state period, representation of transformer generators are same, voltage behind reactance, but it is called voltage behind some subtransient impedance. Okay, if we write this one with R, then it is voltage behind subtransient impedance or voltage behind transient impedance or voltage behind steady state impedance. Generally, you will see that it is again voltage behind transient reactance. Generally, we make R as compared to X in case of alternator or in case of fault analysis because the value of X is very high as compared to the R. So this thing I have written here, I am not reading this again. Whatever I have explained, it is written here. You go through it after class. If you cannot understand, tell me in the next class. So during steady state period, obviously, if the fault is existing there for a long time, then field winding has not the capacity to maintain the air gap flux. So air gap flux will die down. So field winding will be open. The effect of field winding will not be there. So this field winding is not there. It's open circuited. So there will be only armature current. Armature current is fault current. So this is the thing. Now, how to represent transformer for fault? So for transformer, this is the equivalent circuit referred to primary. Since we are using the, we shall use the parallel system, so refer to primary or secondary will be same. Anyway, so for transformer also, since huge fault current is flowing, and this is the no load component of current, so I0 is very, very less as compared to the IF. So generally, we consider this as disconnected. But if we want to take the actual calculation, then we shall consider that one. But this calculation this consideration will make the calculation only complex. That's why we neglect that one. That is not required, because in fault current 1400 ampere, 5 ampere will not affect. So what will be the representation of transformer? Only a series circuit, right? Now R1 plus R2 dash or X1 plus X2 dash or the opposite. Now in power system, they are same. So that's why you go for parallel system in case of fault analysis. So it will be simply this one. Generally, we neglect the resistance as compared to the reactance in case of fault analysis. I have also written here that note that parallel impedance of transformer is same, either base quantities are assumed from primary side or base secondary side. Now, what is fault current? Fault current means fault current flowing through the faulted path. That is another terminology, fault MVA or short circuit MVA. Fault MVA is fault current and pre-fault bus voltage. You can say node voltage. So that is called fault MVA. Why it is required? What is the importance of this? Actually, we select the circuit breaker depending on fault MVA and the fault current. Now this short circuit MVA or fault MVA, this fault current is steady fault current. So root 3 VFL or VLL, root 3 VLIL simply. But there will be a transient fault MVA also. In that case, we take the maximum one, sub-transient one. I have not discussing yet, because generally in the fault calculation, we do not discuss about the transient fault MVA. But that is required when we select a circuit breaker for a particular production purpose. Now, how to calculate the fault current? So at first, you draw a single line diagram of the given power system. Sometimes described, not given, single line diagram is not given. So in that case, from the given description, you have to draw it. Then select a suitable base MVA and convert all voltages and impedance of the power system in power unit. Then draw the reactance or impedance diagram of the power system and show all electrical parameters, voltage, impedance, etc. in the diagram. Identify the fault point in the reactance diagram and connect it with the reference, because it is shorted, means it's shorted to ground, because we are calculating the three-phase dead short circuit. Calculate fault current using circuit theory, using Thevenin equivalent circuit theory. Calculate Thevenin equivalent in the between fault point and the reference, and then calculate the fault. At any point, if you calculate current, then you can do either Thevenin equivalent or Norton equivalent. Thevenin equivalent is easier, so you calculate Thevenin equivalent at the fault point, across the fault point, and calculate current to that through the fault point. Then calculate fault current in ampere or kiloampere, because here fault current will come in the power unit. Then you have to convert it into ampere or kiloampere, should be. If it is our MVA, then pre-fault bus voltage should be given. Then accordingly, you calculate fault MVA. That is, I have not written here, because this is, I have written for the calculation of fault current. But if in addition fault MVA is asked, then you just add the root 3 VLIL. In that case, pre-fault bus voltage will be given. If it is not given, then you assume it as one per unit, right? Say pre-fault bus voltage is one per unit. Your fault current will be in per unit. Then total fault MVA you can calculate in per unit. Then you can multiply it by MVA, okay? Then your pre-fault bus voltage will not be equal in kV.
Now let us go for one example. The same example I think I that I have given you is the no, not the same. There is a generator and motor anyway. Is it same? Anyway. So here it is written, there is a solid three-phase fault of at the HT terminal of the motor transformer of the power system given in example one. Draw the reactance diagram of the network under faulted condition and calculate fault current. Everything will be note, but you must practice it by your own. Then at the first step is you convert everything in per unit. Since per unit I have already described, so I am not repeating. Just I have given here the values, so I am not repeating those part. So this will be the per unit reactance diagram. Now fault is given, you see fault is given. Where is fault? Fault is at the HT terminal of the motor transformer. So this is the motor. So this is the motor transformer, HT terminal. So here is the fault, right? So now in reactance diagram, you have to identify that one. Right? So HT terminal of the motor transformer. So this one. So this is the line, this is the transformer. So the line side is the H side and the motor side is the LT side. Aste. So this motor side, line side will be the faulted point, not the motor side. Understood? Now you short it. Now we can solve the circuit. So this will be the fault current, right? A discussion of fault current I am doing later. Now if the fault point be the LT terminal of generator, let me mark the point A, B, this is A, C. Now tell me, if I say that there is a fault at the LT terminal of the generator, sound ka bondo karna.
Point A.
If I say that this is HT terminal of the generator transformer, then
B.
If I say LT LT stand motor terminal, then
C.
C.
Motor terminal is C or LT side of the motor transformer is the same thing, right? Now, if I say at the middle of the transmission line. Then if you have to just divide it by 2 and just make the fault here. So you separate it by 0.287 by 2 and 2 by 2 on both side and make the fault, identify the fault point. Have you understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Similarly, it may be if it is given in the per kilometer, say 10, the impedance is 10 ohm per kilometer in that way. Then it may be say it may be asked that 30 kilometer from the generator end, 40 kilometer from motor end. So in that way, you have to identify the fault point and short it to the ground. Just that one. Then what will be the equivalent circuit? Just you add these three impedances, so this will be the value. Add these two impedances, this will be the value. So just calculate these two current, one by this one and one by this one, summation of the current. Okay. So ZTH you can calculate, so V by I, or it's simply calculating the solving the circuit, right? So you must not end here, IF equal to this one. Now you see, for this particular example, current is 5 per unit, more than 5 per unit. So
Ma'am, VTH is always 1 PU, or we have to, only in this case it's 1 PU.
Say VTH, actually VTH, if VTH is given, that means in ideal condition, this fault point current cannot be 132 kV because normally power was flowing through the circuit. So it will be near to 132 kV, but not 132, right? So if it is given, then you take that value. If it is not given, then you assume it is 1 per unit. What is the justification? Generally, we do not allow more than 5% regulation, right? So for long transmission line, it will be 0.95 per unit, right? So in that case, we can easily assume it as 1 per unit. Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Otherwise, we have to solve the circuit again. We have to find that one. But generally, in fault study, we do that one. But sometimes the fault pre-fault bus voltage is also given. If it is given, it is fine. You can if this bus voltage is given, then you calculate just current from here and current from here, and then you add. Understood? Otherwise, Thevenin equivalent voltage, and here it will be 1 per unit. For this, it will be 1 per unit, because if you find out Thevenin equivalent, it will be open circuit. You have to open this one from here, right? So open means here, yes, voltage will be 1 per unit. For this particular example, by calculation also, it will come 1 per unit, because it is a isolated system. There is no other source. But in interconnected system, there will be voltage. So IF is this much. So you can assume this is more than 5 per unit. So normally voltage current will be 1 per unit. Now the base current of the fault current, this is very important. Base current is 50, base MVA is collected. Here I have assumed 50, so 50 MVA. Then what will be the base voltage? Here it is 132. Why? Because it was HT side of the transformer. But it will be 11 if it is the LT side, right? So during the identification of fault, you when you calculate the base current, then you must assume, you must think that what will be the base voltage. You do not readily write the 132 or 11. So if it is here, then it will be 11. Here it will be 11. Here it will be 11. Here 132. Here 132. Here 11. Right? In this way. It is very easy, but you think for a while. Otherwise, there may be mistake. Okay. Okay, that's all for today. You write your name and roll number. Okay. Remaining part I shall teach in next class. You write your name and roll number and leave the meeting.